At America's most beloved ballpark, the BR Trojans and Brockton Boxers prepare for a gridiron matchup that these coaches and players won't forget anytime soon. Thank you for watching this Thanksgiving football preview special. I'm John Luck, coming to you from our BTV studios here in Bridgewater. This is the final game of a two-day, five-game schedule at Fenway Park, and the lone matchup that features two teams that made the playoffs this year facing off against each other. We have a lot to get to here on the show, including my conversation with Butch Stearns of Boston 25 Sports. And if you're a player who's going to be taking the field on Wednesday night or someone with an appreciation for high school football, you'll definitely want to stick around and check this out. Dominic Damiano of 4 Deep Sports Talk is also the play-by-play voice of the Brockton Boxers. I do play-by-play on the BR side, so we'll compare some notes ahead of the Thanksgiving Eve clash. Bridgewater-Raynham and Brockton have played each other on Thanksgiving dating back to 2010, so there are some numbers to think about as both Trojans and Boxers fans make their way into Fenway Park. The first one is the number 3. After winning back-to-back games for the first time since the beginning of the annual matchup, Brockton is looking for their third straight victory against the Trojans. The number 6 is the number of one-score games since the rivalry began back in 2010. BR is 4-2 in those games. Now, not included in that stat is a playoff game that took place back in 2015. The Boxers won that game 10-6. However, the Trojans answered back on Thanksgiving with a 27-3 victory. The number 63 is the scoring margin in this Thanksgiving matchup. BR has outscored Brockton 262-199 in those games that go back to 2010. And the final number is 116. This year's Boxers team has outscored last year's Boxers team by 116 points. Before we look ahead to this year's matchup between the Trojans and the Boxers, we want to go back to last year's game that took place at the Regional. Now, in this highlight package, you're going to hear some names that sound familiar for both BR and Brockton, but nonetheless, this was a classic game that came down to the final minute. We're going to start things off in the first quarter as Jason Winode. This was just a goal-to-go situation here. Only had to go 2 yards, stretched it out a long way, but somehow finds Mauricio Powell open in the end zone to put the Boxers in front 7-0. And the Trojans would answer back with 6.5 to go in the first half. Dawson DeBose, a sophomore running back, we've said his name a lot this season, brings it in from 5 yards out to tie the game up at 7, as it's a bit of a youth movement down at the Regional. And in the last 10 seconds of the first half, Mason Berry would come on for the field goal for the Trojans. Now, it either went off his own teammate or off of number 75 for the Boxers, Makai Boston. Either way, a big missed field goal that perhaps played into the final score. We're tied at 7 going into the half. Fast forward now to the fourth quarter. Sophomore quarterback Declan Byrne has been learning on the fly in a roller coaster of a season. And on 4th and 2 in the fourth quarter on Thanksgiving Day, misses Daniel Francis just out of the fingertips of the junior wide receiver. On the ensuing Brockton drive, Jason Winode going deep for Lucas Pyers. Wide open 88-yard touchdown play. Boxers on top 14-7, capitalizing on a big 4th and 2 defensive stop. Now, the next offensive drive, Jason Winode did win the Boxers MVP for the game. He had a lot of passing yards, looking to get a lot of rushing yards here. Maybe ran about 100 yards just in this one play. He spun away from a defender, and Winode is going to put another score on the board, but as you saw there, a little yellow object flying. That's never a good thing if you're on offense and you get a big play like that. Odds are it's coming back, and it did. A personal foul, a blindside block, so the Boxers get set back. Perhaps a big turn in the tide here for both teams. So Winode says, I can't run anymore. Let me pass. Going downfield, finding Cameron Montero, a fellow quarterback, also a wide receiver, bringing the boom to Daniel Francis, outpacing Ryan Braheny for a long touchdown play, 81 yards actually. So now the Boxers in front by 2 scores. Let's go back and show you the replay here, because this is actually really interesting. Watch what happens when Montero gets it, lowering the shoulder on number 11 and outpacing number 12. So the Boxers receivers certainly having themselves quite a fourth quarter. So now we go into the last 3 or 4 minutes here. Declan Byrne, the sophomore quarterback, just basically playing out the string here, going to the end zone, finding the quarterback from the spring, Nolan DeAndre, brings it in from 29 yards out. BR has life now, 21-14 after the PAT. So now football common sense kicks in for the BR Trojans. They're going to go ahead for the onside kick. And I mean, if it works, go for it. BR with the onside kick in that mess of bodies, it would be number 25, Michael Gurley, eventually somehow, some way coming out of this. And Gurley, guess what? It's been all sophomores for most of this highlight package for the Trojans. The sophomore comes up big again. So now we go inside the final minute of play here. Declan Byrne and Ryan Verhenny had a highlight passing play earlier in the year. Add this one there as well. About 30 yards out, the Trojans now within one, 21-20. Lou Pacheco wants to go for broke here, going for two. And he'll also show a little bit of trickery here as Dawson DeBose for Ryan Verhenny, and the ball goes through Verhenny's hands. A valiant comeback effort put together by the BR Trojans. The Brockton Boxers get the win in the SEC Championship by the 21-20 final. Now, Declan Byrne would be named the BR Trojans MVP for the day. He had 6 of 16 passes completed, 74 yards, and 2 touchdowns. Boston 25 has done a great job highlighting Bay State high school football teams and players, and this year will be no different. I had a chance to talk to Butch Stearns as he prepares to host another Thanksgiving program full of highlights and stories that introduces viewers to coaches and players who show a true love for the game. So this is a great game coming up on Wednesday night, BR and Brockton. Obviously a once-in-a-lifetime moment for these students and coaches. But there are those traditionalists that say Thanksgiving football should be on Thanksgiving Day around 10 a.m. and at one of two places. The MIAA has caught a lot of flack for the playoffs, which we'll get to in just a second. But when it comes to Thanksgiving football at a place like Fenway Park, what do you say to those people that think that, you know what, there's only one place that this should be played?
So I want to make a statement sort of about Thanksgiving Day football in Massachusetts, in particular in New England. And I think you know this, but I don't know if people in New England really think about it. We're almost the only place in the country that does Thanksgiving Day football. Like, I've done this story in the Patriots locker room over the years, and you talk to a guy from Texas, you talk to a guy from Ohio, you talk to Florida and California guys, where football is life and death in a lot of ways. They look at you like you have three heads when you ask them about Thanksgiving Day football. So to me, the statement is this: Thanksgiving Day football is not necessarily about where it is or even when it is. That game has so much history for your school, for your towns. I mean, you know, they could play it in the backyard and in a parking lot, I think. So to me, the people that want to criticize that, well, you know, it should be at Bridgewater-Raynham, it should be at Marciano Stadium in Brockton, this is ridiculous. Yeah, well, go to Fenway Park and watch that those teams play at Fenway Park with all the history of that. So again, I think the other criticism is, well, you know, with the new playoff format, we'll talk about this later, it's kind of rendered the Thanksgiving Day meaningless. No, it's rendered it a little less meaningful in some games where a trip to the state championship might be on the line. But again, my statement is that Thanksgiving Day football is meaningful in itself. I don't know if you feel the same way.
I do. When it comes to high school football, a lot of these players, don't forget, if they are seniors, in some cases, this is the final time they're going to put on pads. Now, granted, some of them could move on to Division I, II, or III college football, which is great to hear. But for some of these players, this is it. And, you know, especially for Bridgewater-Raynham, which we'll talk about in a little bit, a lot of these players have played since youth league in Raynham and Bridgewater since fourth and fifth grade. I think the opportunity just to kind of go out there with your teammates and everybody watching, they can be playing this game, you know, in California, just as long as I think as you have that team aspect and those people watching you, you know, there's a way to watch it at Fenway Park. We're going to have the game on replay on BTV and BCA. So there are ways to watch this team play the Brockton Boxers. And, you know, there is tradition, yes, with playing these games at BR and Brockton, but sometimes traditions can change a little bit and change for the better.
I'm going to amend one thing you said. You said a lot of these kids won't go on to play college football. I forget the numbers. I think it's 75% to 80% won't go on to play college football. So think about that. So the chance to play at Fenway Park, whether you're, you know, a kid that is going to play college football, and even that small percentile from Massachusetts who might have a shot at playing major college football or a chance to play in the pros. And we've had a lot of them. The chance to play at Fenway is special. Again, when you think about the history of Fenway, if people don't know about the history of football at Fenway. It goes back a long way. And if you've never been to a football game at Fenway since they brought it back, it's really cool because everybody that grew up in New England has been to Fenway, has had some type of magical experience. You know, I don't know anybody that's ever said, I hate Fenway, rip it down. They might rip it down for other reasons, but, you know, there aren't a lot of places like that. So if you're a kid, again, that's not going to go on and play college and you get a chance to play football at Fenway Park, I don't think I'm passing that up.
And there's, I think, six Super Bowls, maybe eight Super Bowls coming up at Gillette Stadium for BR and Brockton. Their Super Bowl hopes are dashed. Guess what? This is their Super Bowl coming
nice
up.
Nice bonus.
Yeah.
Nice bonus. They'd much rather be playing at Gillette. I'm with you. But, you know, the chance to play at Fenway is a nice bonus.
Another aspect of this game is the fact that Peter Colombo is going to be coaching his final game for the Brockton Boxers. This brings an end to quite the legacy for the Colombo family going back to Armin's days, bringing the Brockton Boxers into national prominence. We've seen Dan Bjorn step aside a couple years ago. We saw Lou Silva step aside. I think the North Attleboro head coach stepped aside at the end of last year, beginning this year, somewhere around there. It seems like we're starting to see kind of that changeover from the older blood to kind of this newer generation. Mm-hmm. And what do you expect to see from high school football as we go into the future with this newer blood coming in?
It's a great question, and I think we could take this in a lot of different ways, but let's look at the NFL. You've got all these young breed analytics coaches, let's call them, like going for it on fourth down a lot more. We've seen it. Quite honestly, I think the big Achilles heel for them is being inexperienced. They don't know how to manage the clock at the end of a game. Most of them don't. Most of them, you know, pee their pants in situations because they're not ready for a situation. Look, people criticize Belichick. They say the game's passed him by. But tell me when you think a game ended and you said Belichick wasn't prepared for that situation. It's almost unheard of. So will that happen in high school with these new coaches? You know, you and I talked before about how they're growing up together, some of these kids with the coaches, and what's that like? I think the coaches are learning on the job. So I don't have an answer for you about how it is going to change. I think it will change. I think a lot of things won't change. To me, being a football guy, I mean, I played at Stonehill College and played flag football after that and played 1 year of semi-pro, and I had no delusions of grandeur. At 5'8 and 3/4, I wasn't going to go to the NFL, but I loved the game and I understood the game, and I was a captain of my college team and I ran some defenses. And football to me is what I loved about it is at any level, it really comes down to, do you like taking your face and stick it in that guy's chest? And do you like enjoy that feeling? That little pain feeling of it, it's smash mouth. It's all the things they say. And it's really your will against another guy's will. And no, that's common in a lot of sports. I think it's more common in football. So I think football is still the same game. It's always been at any level. And I would hope it's not going to change with younger coaches, because I think the good coaches know that you build a team from the inside out at any level.
And we talked before this interview about your relationship with not just Dan Bjorn, but also Peter Colombo. I believe you're going to have a story coming up on the high school football special on Thanksgiving Day. And if you can just share some of what you're going to share coming up on the show on Thanksgiving morning, because we talked and there were some things that I was very surprised about. I thought I knew a lot about Peter Colombo and my mind was blown.
Well, let me start with Danny Bjorn. So Danny and I have been friends for a long time, back to our college days. His brother Dave was a teammate of mine at Stonehill College, and I got to know Dan then. And I think everybody in Bridgewater-Raynham knows Dan's history, but maybe you don't. Like, I thought I knew the whole Colombo history, and I, from a conversation with Peter Colombo the other day, learned some things that I'll tell you in a few minutes that blew me away. But take a good look at Dan and do some research, and I think some of these guys on this team, you know, were able to interact with Dan before he retired as football coach, before he retired as athletic director. But Danny was a phenomenal football player himself, not only at Bridgewater-Raynham, but also at Holy Cross. I mean, Danny was a special football player. He really was. And I think he was one of those unique guys who was able to translate his passion and knowledge and love for the game into his teams, into his kids. I mean, you know, in my opinion, and Dan's history with his finger on the Bridgewater-Raynham program, and this is the ultimate compliment, in my opinion, is that any team that came to play Bridgewater-Raynham, especially in the playoffs when they weren't league rivals, you knew you had to be prepared for Bridgewater-Raynham. You knew you had a dogfight on your hands. And that was common with Brockton, too. So I think, Danny, you know, do your homework. And here's a challenge I would give to the Bridgewater-Raynham players. Before you play this last game, maybe the last time you ever wear a football uniform, do two things. Wake up in the morning and research Jerry Callahan's article in the Boston Herald and read it in the morning. It still stands the test of time. It was written almost 25, 30 years ago, I think, about you being a senior and playing in your last game. It's an amazing, amazing story. And do a little research on the Columbos and look across the field and realize when you're playing against Peter Colombo, you connect a few dots and you have a connection to Rocky Marciano and Marvin Hagler and all the history of Brockton, because that's what the Columbos are. So there's a lot of history in this game, and Peter Colombo is going to be the end of a legacy that is an amazing legacy, one of the most amazing legacies in the history of Massachusetts schoolboy sports. You know, briefly, again, I could go on and on. This will be in the feature. And by the way, our features will be on nine, our specials on Thanksgiving Day. Will be 9:30 in the morning before all the games start. But then we know there's a lot of people that care about football that are going to games and they won't see it then. So at 10:30 at night, we'll be recapping a lot of the games. But I'm going to rerun the Colombo feature because it's about Peter's Peter's dad, Armand, and, you know, and the family. And for people that don't know the history, you know, Armand Colombo was the winningest coach in Massachusetts high school history when he retired. And he stuck around for a long time on the sidelines still with his son as Peter took over. But this Sunday is going to mark a 53-year run as when it was a Colombo on the sidelines. And now it's not going to be that way anymore. And in the piece, you'll see that there are some grandkids that love football, and it may happen again, but continuously it's going to stop after this year. But Armand went to Brockton High School, led them to a championship, went to Stonehill College, went to Archbishop Williams and won three Class D championships, 55 wins, and then came back to Brockton. And when he came back to Brockton, it was 1968, and they went 3-6. They had a losing season that first year, but a lot happened in that next year. The new Brockton High School was built. Rocky Marciano died. And by the way, again, if you don't know the history, the Colombos and Marcianos are tied in so many ways, but Armand married Rocky Marciano's sister. Armand has passed away. Rocky passed away in 68. Peter told his team, we're going to dedicate this season to Rocky. And what you guys need to understand about Rocky, do your homework. And they did. And a lot of them grew up idolizing Rocky and knew that he was an undefeated heavyweight champ. We're not going to lose. And they didn't. They went 9-0 and won the state championship. But the Mrs. Colombo, I forget her first name, I think it's Becky, Peter's mom, Armand's wife, Rocky's sister, is still alive. She's 91. Peter told me the other day, she came to all the games this year. She sat with Peter and watched film. Imagine all the film she's watched over the years. So again, I could go on and on. I worked hard to create a piece that pays tribute to the Colombo legacy. I'm going to tweet them all out afterwards too. I hope people in your area and in Bridgewater-Raynham get to watch it and see it and go find it. But again, if you're a player, if you're a fan, walk across that field at the end of that game and shake Peter Colombo's hand. And you know, he's a part of history, a long history in this state and in your region.
I really hope people watch the show coming up 9:30 on Thanksgiving morning. There's no excuse not to watch because we are playing on Thanksgiving Eve. But
well, here's what you can do. If you're going to a game, mm-hmm. Here's a thought. You can download the Boston 25 app and you can put your headphones on and it's 9:30. You still got half an hour to kick off. You can watch the Colombo piece in the show. And I got a bunch of other features in there on the Hasselbecks, on James Tellier, who's a quarterback from my hometown at Braintree, who's a college football prospect who had cancer and didn't even think he was going to play his senior year and came back from it. And I got another one from Sam Carpenter, who's probably the best kicker in the state. And he's going to Indiana next year, and he's playing in Foxborough. And Foxborough still has a chance this weekend, as you are in my conversation, to go to the Super Bowl. And they didn't expect it. They were a 6-4, a 4-6 team coming into the playoffs, and they're one of the last 16 teams standing, or 32 teams standing in these games.
Yeah, 60 going to the Super Bowl. That's crazy.
Yeah.
And I just hope people really pay attention to the past 5 or so minutes of this conversation, just because everything you said about Peter Colombo, you know, it's enough to kind of give you a little bit of a chill. So we talked a lot about the past. I want to talk about the current BR Trojans. Lou Pacheco is in his second year as BR head coach, quarterback Declan Byrne, and running back Dawson DeBose also in their second year as real game changers. From what you've seen at some of the different high schools across the state, is there any positives that BR fans can take knowing that a coach and the core group of players are kind of learning this game together?
I think what they can take is years from now, I don't know Coach Pacheco, I haven't met him, but I will. I can guarantee you he'll say something along these lines. And the kids you just mentioned, the seniors will say the same things over the years. I bet you Coach Pacheco says, those are my guys when I started. I learned more from them than they learned from me, I'm guessing. And then you talk to them guys and they say, no way. We learned a lot from Coach Pacheco. Because as you talked about, they're both learning together along the way. And you don't forget those relationships. You don't forget those things. And, you know, I'm working on this Hasselbeck feature now. And Don Hasselbeck, who played for the Patriots, who's a grandfather now, and his son Matt are coaching with Matt's son and Don's grandson, Henry, who's the quarterback. And I was just re-listening to the interviews this morning, and both Don and Matt said they're enjoying this so much because of the life lessons that they hope they're teaching these kids. And they, you know, consider Zavarian a very, very special place because they're very guys that are very devout in their faith, and it's a Catholic school. And they were part of the history of Zavarian now. So to have Henry there, who transferred over and came to Zavarian and is now a part of it, it's really cool to do that. So to answer your question directly about a young coach and the young kids, I think it's more about what they're going to learn about each other and the life lessons they're going to learn together as well as the football on the field.
Throughout the years, the Brockton Boxers BR Trojans matchup has been covered by BTV and Brockton Community Access in a collaborative effort to bring you the sights and sounds from either the high school or Marciano Stadium. This year is going to be a little different, obviously, with the game taking place at Fenway Park. I had a chance to talk to Dominic Damiano, the play-by-play voice of the Brockton Boxers on BCA, as we compared some notes before the Boxers and Trojans take the field.
So, Dom, the Brockton Boxers scoring 39 points a game, and I tried doing research back to 04. I didn't see a year where they had more points. And the quarterback carousel there that they've had this year, Joey Capiello, Cam Montero, K.O. Osanubi, and Jaden Wooten, all those players have passing attempts. So what's been behind Brockton's sudden resurgence as far as offensive football?
I think it's, in my opinion, it's come the way these kids have matured and have accepted the offensive scheme, if you will, and just their execution. And they also had other players like Powell that we didn't mention, who's a outstanding Christian Paul, not a great receiver. Paul's number 28. Sometimes he goes to number 27, depending if there's a dirty jersey, I guess. He's an explosive back. And they're just all believing in the system. You know, like you mentioned, two great guys. Capiello's been out for a while. He got hurt in the Pinkerton Academy game. And Montero had the stat. Actually, before that, I apologize. And then you had Montero, who, you know, another great player. And then you have the transplant, K.O. Osanubi, who came in to fill in for when Montero went down. And I think it comes down to these junior players. You know, Powell and Montero, and then you also have, Powell and Christian Paul, the big wide receiver, and you know, the tight end that was out all last year. You have Donovan Monroe, and they've just been, it's just the way they've been just gelling and believing in the system. That's what it looks like from where I'm standing every time.
Yeah, just to turn things around to the BR Trojans side, you know, some of the key players to look out for me revolves around the junior class with Dawson DeBose, Declan Byrne, both juniors on the offensive side of the ball, which is huge, and then Miles Beckett as well on the defensive side. And the one thing that's been intriguing to watch from the BR side has been just kind of the growing that they've done this season. They got smoked the first two games of the season. I think it was 77-0. And then to come back and win, I think it was 5-6 heading into the playoffs. You know, that just shows that they kind of believe in what Lou Pacheco is trying to put out on the football field. And you know, Dawson DeBose, I have some of the stats here from the past few games against Middleborough, 248 rushing yards on 35 carries. against Dartmouth, 220, four touchdowns all in the first half. Against Barnstable, 35 carries, 190 yards. Against Durfee, 16 carries and 184 yards. But it's those yards after contact, which we see is such a huge stat for running-based offenses that, you know, that's something that I think people from BR and Brockton really need to pay attention to that are going to be watching that game at Fenway Park.
Absolutely. I mean, you talked about how BR, and I don't think some of the people, not just in the conference, but some of these teams, like you mentioned, the big game they had against Middleborough came out slow, and now all of a sudden things are starting to grow for Middleborough. They're starting, BR. Now they're starting to see they can execute exactly what the coach wants them to do. And the same thing on the Brockton side. Coach Colombo's last year, and right now they had a great ceremony for him the last home game of the regular season, because God knows what's going to happen with the playoffs. We know what happened in the playoffs. Now they're out of the playoffs, and they're trying to finish up the regular season, getting ready for the basically the next Super Bowl, which is taking on Bridgewater-Raynham.
And finally, BR, Brockton, Fenway Park, the night before Thanksgiving. Yep. A little different than we're accustomed to.
Yeah, true.
But from the Brockton Boxers' side, what is going to be the X factor in getting a victory?
Execution. If they can execute, everyone that sees it, that Brockton, they have the talent to go to the outside. And BR has the talent to eliminate getting to the outside. So if Brockton can pull off what they've been doing for the last, like you talked about early in this conversation, the way they've been executing their offense, and they need Chisholm, they need Batista, the other linebacker, and they need Big Malik Boston to step up. If they can do that, they should be able to pull off a win. But you're playing, again, a resurgent BR team that slowly gets better this whole season. It's going to be a heck of a game.
It's going to be really interesting in the second and third quarters, because that's when you've seen players like Amin Abbasi really come out and play. Declan Byrne, he continues to get better as the game goes on. He starts to develop into more of a dual threat quarterback. But for the X factor for the BR side, I think, is just to play within yourself. Before that play-in game against Wellesley, there was just kind of a different feeling on the field, kind of that relaxed feeling. They were singing along to songs. They were dancing to songs, having fun.
Right.
And they had one of the more entertaining games. Now, granted, it was a loss, but I think if you approach this game just as, you know, a chance to play football, not everything going on around there. Obviously, Fenway Park's going to bring a lot of different emotions into it.
Oh, yeah.
But just playing within yourself and having players like Logan Deneau, Chuck Swenson, on the defensive side of the ball, also Miles Beckett, as I talked about. And on the offensive side, I think it's as simple as just try and provide Dawson DeBose a little bit of extra help from the play calling side. You know, not trying to coach the game, obviously, but do we see maybe more passing from the BR side and maybe make Brockton play a little more honestly on the defensive side of the ball?
Absolutely. I talked to Coach Bjorn the other day, and he says it's how your teams are prepared. So we're going to see one heck of a game. You know, everyone thinks, it might be a 35-20 each way, but I think it's going to be a low-scoring game, and it's going to come down to, again, how your team comes in prepared and who makes the big mistake, because that's how things are scored, and, you know, touchdowns are scored, field goals are made. When you get in, if you have a chance to get into that situation, it's all on execution, how you come into the game prepared.
21-20 a year ago at the regional. We'll see what this year brings. Dom, thanks for joining us.
John, thanks for having me.
Thanks.
And we thank you for watching this Thanksgiving football preview special. Good luck to all the players out there as they get set for a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to take the field at Fenway Park. And we wish you all a happy Thanksgiving. I'm John Locke.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Fenway Park, America's most beloved ballpark. For high school football at Fenway, presented by Cross Insurance. Now it's time to meet the teams. In white and red uniforms, please welcome the away team, the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans. And in black and red, please welcome the home team, the Brockton Boxers. Fans, it is now time for some pregame entertainment. Please welcome the Bridgewater-Raynham High School Band. Fans, tonight we would like to recognize a native of Brockton, Massachusetts, who has served as the head coach of the Brockton Boxers football for the past 20 years. With a career record of 132-72, he has led his teams to 5 Super Bowl appearances and consecutive championships in 2004 and 2005. But more importantly, he has been a friend, mentor, and leader for generations of Boxer students and athletes. Coach Peter Colombo. Thank you for your contributions to the City of Champions and the entire Massachusetts community. We wish you the best of luck in your well-deserved retirement. And now, it is time for our national anthem. Presenting the colors tonight is the Brockton High School JROTC Honor Guard. Here to perform the national anthem is the Brockton Choral Group. Thank you to the Brockton Choral Group. Fans, it is now time for the coin toss. Please welcome the captains of Bridgewater-Raynham and Brockton. Joining them on the field are two captains from the 1972 Brockton Boxers football team that went undefeated in winning their first ever MIAA Super Bowl. Please welcome tonight's honorary captains, Ken Buckley and Dave Furnett. The toss has been won by the Trojans. They've elected to defer to the Boxers.
shadows disappeared. The animals inside came out to play. Went face to face with all our fears. Learned our lessons through the tears. Made memories we knew would never fade. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. He took me in his arms, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said one day you'll leave this world behind. So live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights to never die. My father told me.
Returned by number 4, Matt Turco. Boxers will start at their own 25-yard line. That run by Montero, enough for a boxer. First down.
Here we go, Boxers, here we go.
turnover on downs. Pass broken up by number 13, Donovan Monroe. Brings up fourth down. Boxers will take over from their own 27-yard line.
I don't care. I don't care. No, Sandra. No, I'm a-
Catch made by number 9, Osanubi. Enough for a boxer. First down. That run by Powell, enough for a boxer. First down. Sacked by number 60, Declan Fahey. Pass intended for number 9, OK Osanubi, broken up by number 5, Daniel Francis. Trojans will take over from their own 13-yard line. A big thank you to both the Bridgewater, Raynham, and Brockton cheerleaders and bands that will be entertaining us all night. Flag on the play. Penalty is holding against the Trojans. Incomplete pass brings up fourth down. Back to return for Brockton is Michael Victor. Boxers will take over at the Trojan 38-yard line. At the end of one quarter, we are all tied at zero. Fans, if you visit our Wasabi Fenway Bowl team in the Gate A concourse, you can enter for a chance to win tickets to the Wasabi Fenway Bowl, which will be held on December 17th. The winner will be announced at the end of the third quarter.
Fantuccio. Mr. Fantuccio.
Run by Montero, enough for a boxer. First down. Nine-yard gain by number 15, Powell. That run good enough for a boxer. First and goal. Run by Montero, just short of the goal line. Fourth and inches. Touchdown, Boxers! Touchdown by number 9, OK Osanubi. Extra point is no good. Returned by number 26, Owen King. Tackled by number 52, Christian Pena. Trojans will start at their own 36-yard line. Catch made by number 35, Amin Abbasi. Tackle made by number 52, Christian Pena. Run by number 6, Dawson Dubose, enough for a Trojan first down.
Stupid shorties is a little bit.
run by Declan Byrne, enough for a Trojan first down. That run good enough for another Trojan first down. Tackle made by number 21, Luke Turco. Time out, Trojans. Fans, make sure to stick around for the halftime entertainment as Brockton High School will be presenting their 24-carat celebration of Bruno Mars' music. Ball start, Trojans. Tackle made by number 7, Rowan Baptista. Yeah. Timeout, Brockton. Yard field goals, no good. Brockton will take over on down. Flag on the play. Call is holding against Brockton. We have reached halftime. Your Boxers 6, Trojans 0.
Hey! I can see my little bike sticking like a sore thumb. Yeah!
We'll be right back.
Let's hear it for the Brockton High School Marching Band. Fantastic. Foul against the Boxers. Personal foul. Trojans will start in Boxer Country. That run by Declan Byrne, enough for a Trojan first down.
We repeat to 17, but... Okay. Okay.
Trojans touchdown. Number 6, Dawson DuBose. Extra point is good. Trojans go up 7-6. Boxers will start from their own 35-yard line. Okay, Osanubi, touchdown, Boxers.
Thank you.
Trojans will start from the 35-yard line. Flag on the play, false start. Trojans. Catch made by number 35, Amin Abbasi. Enough for a Trojan first down. That run good enough for a Trojan first down.
Measure, look at it, look at it.
Time out, Boxers. Cam Montero, touchdown, Boxers. Extra point by John Dumas is good. Thank you. Trojans will start at their own 28-yard line. That run good enough for a Trojan first down. Dawson DuBose, touchdown, Trojans. False start against the Trojans. Boxers will start at their own 48-yard line. Thank you. Once again, a big thank you to our cheerleaders and our bands for keeping us entertained all throughout the night. That run, good enough for a boxer. First down. Flag on the play. Holding against the Boxers. Timeout, Brockton. Catch made by number 84, Christensen Paul. Enough for a boxer. First and goal. Kim Montero, touchdown, Boxers. Returned by number 16, Dana Overall. That catch good enough for a Trojan first down.
Yeah.
At the end of three quarters, the Boxers 25, Trojans 14. We can now announce the winner of the Wasabi Fenway Bowl ticket winner. The Wasabi Fenway Bowl will be held on December 17th. The winner is Tim Odom. Congratulations, Tim. You will receive a phone call with instructions on how to pick up your tickets. Tim Odom, congratulations. Flag on the play. Holding Trojans. Tackle made by number 21, Luke Turco. Flag on the play. unsportsmanlike conduct. Boxers. That run by Declan Byrne, enough for a Trojan first down. Tackle made by number 55, Jamie Chisholm. Timeout, Boxers. Fumble on the play, recovered by number 52, Christian Pena. Turnover. That run good enough for a boxer. First down. Catch made by number 5, Daniel Francis. Enough for a Trojan first down.
Yeah.
Tackle made by number 7, Rowan Baptiste. Boxers take over from the Trojan 47-yard line. Flag on the field. Holding Boxers. Touchdown, Michael Victor. run by number 75, Mackie Boston. Tackle made by number 47, Tyler Erickson. Tackle made by number 19, Shamik Williams. Tackle made by number 20, Zaquan Barnes. touchdown, number 11, Matthew Mullins. Fans, we want to remind you to check your surroundings as you leave the stadium. On behalf of everyone here at Fenway, we want to thank you for coming to America's greatest ballpark to celebrate high school football. Congratulations to Coach Peter Colombo on a wonderful career.
It was definitely big. We knew Coach Colombo was his final year. We needed to let Coach Colombo go out good with the win. So I definitely think it was definitely on our minds all game, getting Coach Colombo his final win, definitely.
Yeah, it was super big for all of us. We came into here. We had a little memorial for him during the week. I'm just coming to Brockton, so he's been nothing but great to me, and I'm super grateful for that. And I'm just super happy he got his last game to win. And we played great, so I'm happy as a team, too.
First half, they kept you from those big chunks. Those started coming in the second half. It's only a matter of time with that.
Yeah, definitely. We went into the halftime, and we say we're one block away from big plays. So our line made adjustments to that, and we got the one blocks, and we ended up making big plays.
Exactly. We went to the locker room. We made plans to make big plays, and that's exactly what we did. Our linemen came in clutch. They started to stop getting cut. So they did a great job. Without them, we wouldn't be nothing. So I'm super happy for that.
It's like finishing the season on this stage with a win.
Oh, it definitely is. Winning our conference, you know, this is the second year winning our conference back-to-back. And it definitely makes it more special because, like, I grew up with all these guys, and we've just been in it. We've been playing football for a while, and it's definitely a big one for Coach Colombo, definitely. So it's definitely a great win.
It's a great thing. This beautiful stadium, and we have a great coach. He led us throughout this, and I'm so happy. I'm ending my high school career, so I'm more than happy to get a ring, and especially with the kids I grew up with since I was 5-6 old. So it was the best feeling. I'm super grateful for this. That's something I'm going to cherish forever.
The back and forth you guys are having with Brockton BR going into the locker room. Did the crowd for BR kind of fire you guys up a little bit, especially as you came out for that second half, because you guys really took off?
Oh, yeah, definitely. That gave us a lot of energy, getting booed and stuff. We talked to the guys. We were like, you hear how crazy they're talking right now. So we got to go in there and show them what's up.
Yeah, and honestly, that was a great feeling, seeing a whole fan section boo us. It gave us a lot of momentum, and it obviously worked against them, and I'm super happy for that.
You know, been looking forward to this since the summer, knowing we'd be here at Fenway, and kind of knew we had a special group, and I'm very proud of the way they played. 9-2, it's a great way to wrap it up, it really is.
How great is it to win your last game? I mean, if you lose, that sticks with you.
Well,
for a
I had three Super Bowl losses to end my season, and this feels a lot better. And, you know, being here, special place, and great crowd, great atmosphere, and very proud of our performance.
Yep. I was talking to Cam and KO. They held the big runs in check in the first half. You had to chip away.
Yeah.
Is it sort of just a matter of time, though?
I mean, based on what they've done all year, yes. They made each other better and kind of ding-dong off each other all year. And with that big front, you know, you get they get lost back there, and then the next thing you know, they're flying down the field. So two special athletes, and very blessed to have them for my last season playing together. It was great.
They honored you pregame on the big board. What was that like?
It was good until I looked up and saw that ball spot on the back of my head. I don't see that. There's a big close-up of that. But, no, that was I didn't expect it. And people have been great. I've been hearing from a lot of people, opponents, old players, teammates, and I really appreciate it. I don't like being the center. These kids do all the work. My coaches, great players make great coaches. I've said that from day one, and I've been blessed to coach a lot of great kids and be surrounded by, you know, excellent, great coaches. I mean, this is my life, man. It's, you know, 50 years ago, we won a Super Bowl, me and my dad, right up the street at BU. And, you know, it's a great, the legacy and the brotherhood of Brockton football, it's really a special thing. It's 125 years, this is since 1897, and it's a special place. And I'm just, you know, I guess been around for a lot of it, so it's been awesome.
Coach, the fact that this took place against BR, you're friends with the NPR, we know about BR and Brockton's history in the Super Bowl. The fact that it was against BR at Fenway Park, what does that mean to you?
For years we played, you know, we had various opponents on Thanksgiving. The matchup with BR, I mean, half the people I grew up with live in Bridgewater, so it's a great rivalry. We used to spend all day getting home from Waltham. Now we go right up the street. It's a great program. Every game has been a dogfight, and it's been a special rivalry, and it's been good for our program and theirs, I think.